I want to recognize Tony, who's actually here on the ground making things happen for the East Africa region. And he has done quite impressive things that I think the whole of IBM is learning from that. The second thing is I just want to tell you about my own story. I was born and raised in Addis Ababa, and I was fortunate enough to get a scholarship. Actually, the funny thing is, initially, you know, I was doing well in school, math and science and so forth, but I actually wanted to be a lawyer. I had no idea about innovation, science and technology and so forth until I got admitted to MIT and Caltech first, and Harvard rejected me because the whole idea was to go to Harvard to study law and so forth. It's at that point that my eyes really opened up to innovation. So I went to MIT, I did physics, engineering, computer science, and I continued and did my PhD there. So after that, I actually went straight and joined IBM. And the main reason that I selected IBM versus many other companies was because of the innovation culture that they have. IBM was working at the cutting edge of science and technology. They were really pushing the frontier. And beyond that, they were working on things that were actually having a lot of impact globally. I mean, if you take a look at some of the things that IBM Research has done, they were the first ones who worked on the first big-scale computation machine in 1944. One of the things that's enabling your computers today is DRAM. DRAM was invented in IBM, and that's how you have your memory in your computer. If you look at speech recognition, the reason that you are able to talk to machines or computers and interact with them was because of the speech recognition that was invented at IBM. If you look at your hard disk, it was invented at IBM. I won't go into all of these details. If you look at why we are able to have GPS system, it's the Sigi chips that were invented at IBM. A lot of cutting edge nodes in terms of chips, they are being invented at IBM as we speak. And of course, supercomputers. We had the first supercomputer that played chess with the best chess master in the world, and obviously we won. And recently we had actually a system called Watson, right? Watson went and played with Jeopardy players, and they put, you know, Watson actually put them to shame, and was widely broadcast, and we got the day off, and we're celebrating at home, watching TV and having some drinks and so forth. So that was good. And of course, supercomputers is a big deal at IBM Research. And the technology that I'm working on is actually something that will go into the supercomputers. I'm working on what's called silicon nanophotonics. The whole idea is in the chips that we're making, we actually want to replace all the copper wires with tiny fibers that are directly integrated within your chips, right next to the transistors. And their main function will be to basically replace all the electrical signals that go in with light pulses. So if you can do that, you can reduce the power that's consumed by your computer, you can have a lot of bandwidth, and maybe at some point, those technologies could help us, you know, make your iPad into a supercomputer that's personal to you, that you can use for a lot of applications that you want to do. So there's a lot of innovation that's happening at IBM, and I think now you probably realize that this is quite different from some of the perceptions that you might have, which is IBM makes personal computers. We're completely in a different regime now. We do a lot of research in the research division, but as a company, we actually work on providing business solutions to many of our customers, and I'll come back to that. So we have 9 research labs around the world, about 3,000 employees. I'm located in the one in New York, which is the Watson Lab. And one trend that you see is that these research labs are actually expanding to emerging markets. In the 90s, we went to China and India. And just, I think, last year, we went to Brazil. And the main reason that we're going there is we have the cutting-edge innovation to solve problems. But then most of the problems and the opportunities actually exist in these emerging markets. So that's very exciting for any of our researchers. It doesn't matter where we are. We want to work on those problems. And those are opportunities for innovation. We want to use the instruments that we have developed already, the cutting edge innovations that we have by now, and go there, and based on that, using it as a platform, we want to go to the next level of innovation. And that's what we're doing as a company. So our core research includes nanotechnology, services, mobile internet, high-performance computing, obviously, and social software. But we're kind of expanding our horizon. We're broadening it into environment, energy, logistics, transportation, computation, computational biology, environmental resource management, and so forth. So we are really expanding and going to any area that's exciting and that will give us a new frontier for innovation. And in order to make that happen, we're actually now working more in terms of like a joint program scheme. So we go, we approach companies, we work with, we identify the problems that they have, and then we say, okay, you know, these are the things that we can do. And this is the problem that you are having. Let's sit together and see what we can do. How do we innovate together? So we have a lot of interaction back and forth and so forth. And we're expanding globally, as you can see. All over, all across, our researchers are going and solving problems. And this concept of collaboration is really, really being pushed by our management. So actually, one of the things that intrigued me as an African was why do we have this innovation culture? Why do we have it at IBM? And I think there's two core components to it. I mean, the more I look into it. One is the fact that the research agenda is very balanced and very broad, so with a lot of disciplines. We have physicists who are kind of moving atoms, you know? If they see a few atoms that are out of place, they have the capability to go and move them back into their place. But at the same time, we have computer scientists, electrical engineers who are working at the system level. We have services people who are trying to like put everything together and see how they can have impact on other companies. And all these people are actually interacting with each other. None of these people are like staying in a lab by themselves and doing their own thing. They are encouraged to interact with each other, with the business guys, with the system delivery guys, and so forth. And that, I think, really helps innovation. And the other fact is that we're kind of integrated. We might be working on nanotechnology, the next cutting-edge chip. But at the same time, we're making sure that that thing is going into our processors, it's being integrated so that we make the best servers in the world. That's going to help the cloud system that we have. We're going to be providing services using those systems. And on top of that, we have a lot of mathematicians who are coming up with a lot of mathematical models who can enable our analytics. So we are encouraged to think in that manner, in a very integrated manner. So there's two messages here. One is, obviously, we need a lot of, for Africa, you know, to talk about innovation, we need a lot of investment, even in the most cutting-edge science and technology. And second is that we have to have this cross-disciplinary approach to our research, to our interaction, and so forth. So obviously this, you know, innovation has led to a lot of awards. I'm not going into it, and, you know, a lot of Nobel Prizes and so forth. What's impressive for me is the fact that these guys are actually in the labs. So in a sense, the young guys who join IBM, I've been there for 7 years or so, we actually have an opportunity to go and talk to them. Not only to talk to them, but I can go and have lunch with them and work on the next invention in the cafeteria. So the question is, when is this going to happen in Africa? How are we going to influence it and make it happen? If we can't do that now, when will it happen? Or are we always going to be looking at the next invention that's going to be coming from be it China or India or the US or so forth? When will we be ready to kind of encourage that culture? There's also a lot of discussion throughout this conference about IP. IBM has been a leader for 19 years. Every year, we have more than 5,000 patents. That's quite a lot. And obviously, we're encouraged to have patents because anytime we submit a patent or we file a patent, we get an award. So there is an incentive there. But the main reason that we do this patenting is because we have to protect our investment. We're investing a lot in our technologies. We obviously have to protect our investment. Whenever we see a need for releasing these patents, we actually do that. I think there was a case where for some open society and so forth, we actually give them a lot of patents and so forth. So it is important that when we're thinking about innovation, we really pay a lot of attention to our IP laws, how we make it easy for everyone to file and protect their inventions, and at the same time make sure that they can interact, talk about all these innovations and so forth. Now, so I told you about all this innovation that's happening, from nanotechnology all the way to services and analytics and so forth. So now I think we're at a very different regime. We're at a very new point where everything is instrumented because of all the inventions that we have made. Everything is interconnected. You know, people can talk to each other easily, but not only people. Devices can talk to each other. And more than that, all these devices that we have, they have become intelligent. So all this instrumented, interconnected, and intelligent world is giving us a new opportunity to think and act very differently. We have to reconsider our culture, we have to reconsider our own even personal behaviors and so forth. And this is a time for, you know, a change in economically, socially, and technically. I think we have a lot of opportunities for new things to happen. So what do I mean by that? Let me just give you a few examples. For every human, there is actually a billion transistors, if you really like think about all the numbers. And each one of these transistors actually cost 10 millions of a cent. So really, these things are cheap. They're like commodity, very, very cheap commodity. We have about 30 billion RFIDs throughout the world. We have more than a billion camera phones. And almost like 85% of the automobiles contain some sort of data recorder. So, I mean, it's amazing. When I go to Addis Ababa, I mean, my friends have the most advanced camera phones compared to what I have. So, I mean, we live in a very different world now. We have the ability to measure, we have the ability to sense, we have the ability to monitor almost everything. It's at the tip of our fingers. And things are interconnected. We live in a very interconnected world. We have about 2 billion people on the internet. We have 4 billion mobile phone subscribers. And about a trillion devices in the world are kind of, you know, connected. There's this thing called Internet of Things. So almost everything is getting interconnected. And once again, this gives us a new opportunity, a new way of interacting and talking to each other, for people as well as for systems. So it's not just about instrumentation and interconnection. We actually live in a very intelligent world. You know, our supercomputers are crunching, you know, they're trying to look into viruses and kind of do some sort of sequencing and so forth so that we understand how we can do disease prevention. We have medical data that's being analyzed using analytic systems and so forth so that we can actually have better healthcare delivery systems. We have tons of data that's being analyzed to basically have more accurate forecast about crops and so forth. So all this is kind of a new view of the world. For the first time, everything is digitally aware, everything is interconnected. That means that we can respond very quickly, but not only just quickly, we can be very accurate about it. And also, we can basically do some sort of modeling and optimize the future. I mean, look at some of the examples. It could be distributed energy, it could be buildings, it could be supply chain, it could be water systems. You can instrument all of these things. And then using the data that you get, you know, very high quality data, very trusted, secure data, you can actually apply analytic models on it, and then you can do some sort of predictive modeling. And then from that modeling, you can have a management system that actually will go back, feedback, and control the systems. That means that you're operating more efficiently and doing much more wiser business. So, and this definitely opens up a lot of opportunities. I don't even want to go into this issue about traffic. I know it's a very sensitive issue for this conference, but we can do very smart traffic systems. I mean, look, the solutions are here. It's for us to decide how to implement them or, you know, pass this opportunity. We can have very intelligent oil fields, healthcare. We can really manage our energy, grid, infrastructures, and so forth. And for Africa, I think it's the time is now, while we're building our infrastructures, to make sure that we're really thinking 20, 30 years down the line and making sure that we have instruments embedded in the system so that later down the line, we don't have to come back and, you know, tear everything apart and start afresh. Just to give you some of the examples of these initiatives that IBM has taken on, for the city of Rio, for example, we helped them set up a city center. So this city center has tons of data. It could be on weather patterns, meteorological data, data about land and so forth. And what they're doing is they're embedding analytic systems, basically mathematical models that helps them predict ahead of time on things such as landslide, rainfall, and so forth, which means that the city could actually respond very fast about any type of disaster or emergency that could happen. They could basically have information about 24 hours ahead, and they have information to act on right away. So they have automated alert systems, instantaneous mobile communication, automated email systems, and so forth. So which is, you know, really impressive thing to do, to have like one coordinated center where you can actually, you know, act very quickly. We're helping a lot of oil sectors. For example, one of the companies, Stat Oil, we're actually helping them with some smart wireless sensors so that they can actually do real-time monitoring, send the data, and that data could actually be analyzed in real time, which means that at the end of the day, you can have higher production output, you can actually reduce cost and so forth. Even in Kenya, we're actually working with Kenya Petroleum to help them use some of our systems to, you know, manage their equipment, infrastructure, and IT and so forth. Smarter transportation, I think everyone in this room has opinions about it, but it is doable. There are examples, real life examples, where IBM actually went and helped Stockholm. We went into Singapore to help them out with their toll system, which is very dynamic based on the amount of traffic that's coming in. That we also helped them enable some sort of mobile payment while they're driving, and we actually helped them do some sort of prediction. What's the traffic flow here? Can you actually send a message to some of the passengers so that they could be rerouted based on how things are happening in real time? And again, this is because we have instruments, everything is interconnected, and everything is intelligent. For the sake of time, maybe I'll be short, I won't dwell on this, but even things like, you know, utilities, you can actually embed sensors that kind of understand how much energy usage you have, when do you use it, and so forth. So you can regulate your use of energy throughout the day. You can do the same for your grid. How is your electric flow throughout the city? Can you do some sort of optimization? Is there a point of failure? If so, can that device actually send out a message to the control center? And right away, there will be an emergency response so that it could be fixed and so forth, instead of, you know, calling for 2 days, as Orlando pointed out yesterday. So there are solutions for these problems. And actually, Tony kicked off a Smarter Nairobi initiative. If you have a lot of questions, you can talk to him. We're actually trying to see what we could do to help Nairobi. And just to make a few more points, I think all these things could actually be very helpful for us, you know, any African country. Let's look at, for example, our resources. To, you know, basically what we're doing in a certain extent is we're kind of, you know, just mining and so forth and sending out our energy. Nigeria is selling a lot of oil, but at the same time, I think they spend a lot of money, you know, buying oil. Look at our diamond. You know, diamond is being mined here, it's being exported, and it's being cut in India, then it's being set in Belgium or some European country, and then it's being sold in the US, right? We look at our cotton, we look at our coffee. Why can't we use these technologies to actually add value? I think we can. We have to be smart about it. These instruments are here now, so we should be using them to help us capture more value. We need to be moving up the value chain by using the instruments that are already available now. One initiative that we're doing, for example, is if you look at 70% of the world's cocoa is grown in West Africa, and it goes to fuel about 75 billion industry, but West Africa actually just gets 7%, actually 4 billion of that, you know, revenue. So we need to be capturing more of it. And one thing that IBM is doing is working with Mars company to sequence the cocoa genome so that actually African farmers could have better control on what type of trees that they grow, how could they make them disease resistant, how can they make them resistant to drought and so forth, and how could they make better type of cocoa depending on the different type of world markets that exist. And we think that that type of system where you're actually using a supercomputer to sequence the cocoa genome could have direct impact even on the farmers directly on the ground. I actually really like this example. This is an initiative in Egypt. We helped them set up a nanotechnology center. And the idea is they will use some of the nanotechnology solutions, such as solar cells, to capture energy. And also they want to desalinate the water. So they're actually using nanomembranes to do the same. So now you combine those two technologies and you can have a desalination plant where you're powering the plant itself using renewable energy. And of course, that leads to not only clean water, but also to sharing of IP. You know, this is being done in direct collaboration with IBM. The researchers are coming to IBM, and some of our researchers are going to Egypt to work together. So in the end, we actually share this IP, which means that any of these solutions could be implemented anywhere in the world where they need this type of solutions. Obviously, this picture is kind of outdated. If you look at the mobile phone, it's kind of old. I wouldn't be surprised if he has an iPhone 4S by now. But the point that I want to make here is also, I mean, I think you're very well aware of this point. The wireless industry has changed Africa, right? The infrastructure is there, but it's not just about using it for communication. You know, you can use it for healthcare, you can use it for education, you can use it for many things. And IBM is actually also working, I think, in Tanzania on a project where we can use mobile technologies for some sort of drug delivery systems and managing how the supply chain goes and so forth. And also, we're working with Airtel in 16 different countries. And the idea is actually there to have a better mobile infrastructure and management system where you actually are using the state-of-the-art solutions, state-of-the-art systems, state-of-the-art software and services that are embedded into this mobile technologies. You are using advanced voice technologies, advanced analytics, and I think this type of collaboration actually will help the next set of innovation, which is we can then use these mobile devices to do other innovations in terms of healthcare, access to market for farmers, and all those things. It's really the building block. One last thing that's very close to my heart is skill development. Again, the reason I'm able to do cutting-edge technology is because I got a chance to go to the US and get educated. So the question is, can we actually use the smart systems to even revolutionize our education system? Can we use some of these mobile technologies or smart systems and so forth to have some sort of tailored delivery of education to our students? Can we make our classrooms very smart? And I think we can. Can we actually use these systems to help the school management so that, you know, they know about students, they know how well they're doing in terms of the school management and so forth? And third point is, how do we build good collaboration? I've told you about, you know, how we do collaboration at IBM, but I think it's very important to have collaboration on some of the cutting-edge technologies with various companies, with various institutions and so forth. IBM is doing something in this aspect. For example, we have a corporate services core, which is similar to the Peace Corps, where we choose the best actually in the company, and we send them to different emerging markets so that they go and try to use our IT solutions and so forth so that they can help local people. For example, in Africa, I think we have sent over 350 people. And even in Kenya, I think they're working with the ICT board. They're trying to kind of revamp the IT system for the postal service and so forth. So IBM is doing an effort, is making an effort, but at the same time, I think we really have to be aggressive. From here, we need to be aggressive about these collaborations. It's through these collaborations that we can learn quite a lot. So, I mean, just to conclude, I personally, as an African, I really find the IBM research model extremely innovative, and I'm learning a lot from it, and I think there's a lot that could be, you know, like used. Most of the models that we have there could be used here. There's a lot of innovation that's happening now. The world is instrumented, intelligent, interconnected. It's time for us to use it for many things. When we're building our infrastructures, let's think about it, our water systems, our grid, everything that we're doing, we should be looking at it from that context. And finally, you know, let's make sure we do not reinvent the wheel. There are technologies that really exist now. We do not need to duplicate them, but we need to be working on the next set of innovation. How do we use them as the springboard to go to the next frontier? Just think about the mobile phone. How has it enabled us, you know, to leapfrog, right? we need to be thinking from that perspective. These things are cheap, they're a commodity. How do we change our mindset so that we go to the next level? We will be the next leaders in the world in terms of technology. I think it's possible. So with that, I would like to finish. Thank you.
Thank you.